Recorded Books presents Queen Amid Ashes, A Sun-Eater Story by Christopher Ruocchio, narrated by Samuel Roukin. Chapter 1. The Sun is High. The red light of battle still scratched the sky above Thagura, as the wreck of inhuman ships went to cinders in the upper airs. Each streak of light, like the mark of a claw, left its smouldering wound upon the heavens as the vessels burned and fell. The enemy had never seen us coming. For 10 years the Cielcin had besieged Thagura. For 10 years they had hounded its millions, hunted them for sport, gathered them into camps, into ships for transport to the fleet that had hung in orbit like a school of vampires, stooping to suck the blood of the world. We had come as fast as we could, but the space between the stars is vast, and even the fastest and the mightiest dromans of the Imperial fleet are not enough to bridge such distances with haste. We had set out as soon as word of the attack reached us by quantum telegraph, but ships are far slower than words, and though we were victorious, it seemed a hollow victory, for we had saved little more than a desert. The locals had put up a fight. The black ruins that dotted the red world said that much at least. And in the wake of our assault, we'd had reports of survivors in the hinterlands, of whole towns gone underground, retreating into the tunnels and cave warrens Thagura's first settlers had dwelt in before mankind brought air to that arid world. But of the great cities of Thagura, and of Seldona most of all, only bones remained. Seldona of the Hundred Gates, Seldona of Many Towers, Seldona of the Rock. Only the rock remained. The rock and the broken fingers of those many towers strewn beneath it. "'Tis an evil place, Hadrian," said Valka, coming to my side. She wore no armor, no uniform of Empire or our company, but dressed in her fashion after the manner of her own people. In high boots and flared trousers, and the old red leather jacket whose left sleeve, unzipped almost to the elbow, revealed the dense fractal intaglio of her Tavrosi clan, Salash, the tattoo whose lines proclaimed her lineage to all with the wit to read it. The winged shadows of our flyers cut the rusty soil like knives, and our own shadows mingled as she drew level with me. "No," I said, not turning to look at her. "Evil has been done here. It is not the same. Would that I might have seen the city in the fullness of her flower before the enemy came. Seldona lay unrolled like a carpet beneath us. The ruined city yawned beneath us. A black stain upon that red world, its tumbled towers and white streets charred with plasma fire, the silicates fused to flakes of glass that crunched underfoot. The planet's earlier settlers had built their city high upon the knees of the rock, terrace upon terrace, so that once her silver fountains and white halls had risen like the palace of some fairy queen. Brightly painted she once had been, the queen of the cities of Thagura. Her houses blue and gold and white, her banners snapping in the sirocco, and everywhere the avenues brimming with the green of date palms and olive trees. No more."
"Where's our man?"
asked Polino, who had volunteered to captain my guard for this journey down to the surface. Unlike both Valka and me, he had donned his helmet, the faceless ivory casque of an Imperial legionnaire, albeit one crowned with the red crest of Achilleuch. He carried his energy lance in the crook of his right arm, its bladed head swaying as he hurried ahead of the double line of our escort.
"Shouldn't he be here to greet us?"
I shook my head. "They'll have seen us descend," I said, and pointed up at the ruined road that once had led to the gates of the palace atop the rock itself. Black ruins moldered ahead and above us then, like the worn-down teeth of some chop-fallen skull.
but we're not in the palace proper yet. Malyan's people said they'd make contact nearer the crag. 'Tis a miracle there's anyone left alive at all, said Valka, sweeping golden eyes over what remained of Saldona. It was her first time seeing anything of the terrors the enemy left in its wake. She had not come to the surface with me on Rustum, had not seen the black scar of the old city stretched for miles across the face of that far world, nor seen the squalor of the ship city the survivors had built for themselves. But there are, I said as bracingly as I could manage. You heard the transmission. The Baroness herself is alive and saved many of her people. I hooked a thumb through my shield belt, reassured myself that the hilt of my sword still hung proper in its clasp. It would not do to dwell upon all that was lost. We were victorious. Our fleet and our new flagship, the Tamerlane, had broken their blockade in less than a standard day. After 10 years of harvest and occupation, Thagura was free at last, and though there was pain and loss and tears of grief, there would soon be tears of joy and song and hope as man rebuilt. In years to come, a new city would rise from the ashes of the old, and in time, all that would remain of this destruction would be the tale of man's endurance. Old men would sit at card tables in cafes along the city streets, and speak of war to children for whom the very notion was a kind of myth. Boys would play at being Cielcin themselves, and those old men would shake their heads, knowing better, but not knowing how to teach their wisdom to those who followed on. But I gave little thought to such things then, and clapped Polino on the shoulder. "Let's move," I said, and raising my voice addressed all the men of my guard. "Eyes forward, lads. Let's make a proper show for the Baroness. Let her know we're here." As one of my guards shifted their lances, the ceramic bayonets flashing in the red light of Thagura's sun, gone were the red ceramics of our old uniform, the black tunics and blocky foreign style of armour. My red company had been utterly transformed. What had begun as a mercenary outfit half my life before had been transmuted into an imperial force. The brand with which the Emperor had anointed me and made me his knight still seemed to rest upon my shoulder, and the touch of it upon my brow still burned like the touch of one of the seraphim of old. I was a knight of the Empire, no longer a rebel, no longer an outcast, no longer a boy. Nearly half my life I had quested for peace and Vorgosos. I had found Vorgosos only. The rock loomed above us, a great red dome of the living stone that towered thousands of feet above the sands of the Tagarine Erg. The rock and the palace that crowned it had served House Malyan for generations, and though the palace was gone, the faces carved upon the face of the rock remained. Thagura had been settled thousands of years before, and the nobles who ruled over it had carved their likenesses 1,000 feet high into the walls beneath the blasted crown. The relief images of Baron Aram Malyan, who raised up the city, and his son Vahan, stood to either side of the rising path, their hands supporting the rim of the Acropolis, their muscled bodies seeming to support the palace their family called home. I had seen them from the flyers as we approached, but seeing them then from the ground, it was a humbling experience. I was overawed. I had already travelled far in my 40 years, had plumbed the depths of Vorgosos and knelt before Caesar himself in the Georgian chapel of the Perennine Palace on Forum. But there is no shortage of wonders in creation, and the twin colossi carved into the face of the rock were mighty indeed. How many hands had laboured there, and for how many decades? Still they had not fallen, though the palace above them was dust. "Oro, sound the horn," I called to the herald, as we mounted the steps to the plaza that stretched beneath the feet of the colossi. Shattered masonry lay all around, and the lesser statues in the dry fountain lay broken. Old blood stained the tiles, and everywhere the signs of old violence glowed white-hot for those with eyes to read.
The herald sounded his clarion, and the bright noise of that trumpet echoed and died on the breeze. There was nothing. No one.
Black planet, Pellino cursed. It's quiet.
There is nothing left, Valka agreed, and drew close beside me. There aren't even birds. Do you see? She was right. We might have stood upon the surface of an airless desert moon. A tall banner, 100 feet high, swayed from one iron pillar at the corner of the square. White with 3 blue lions, the banner of House Malyan. All the world was still.
Oro, again, I said.
Again the trumpet sounded.
Bang!
A bolt of violet light struck the tiles of the square, not a dozen feet from where I stood. And the trumpet blast died at once, choked off. My men reacted at once, swinging their lances from the parade holds to readiness as they crouched and searched for targets. I stepped forward, one hand slipping to the hilt of my unkindled sword while the other thumbed my shield. The static crackle of the energy curtain flickered about me, and I shifted to better place myself between Valka and our attackers.
"Hold your fire!" I shouted, and raised a hand.
It was the bolt of an energy lance that had struck the tiles. The Cielcin did not use such lances, preferring to fight with scimitar and claw, and the flying snakes that chewed men's flesh and slavered blood as they flew from target to target.
"Show yourselves," I called. "We are men like you." "If your herald blasts his horn again, we'll shoot him dead,"
came a rough voice from the roof of the crumbled building that lined the far side of the square.
"There may still be pale about."
Both hands raised then, and visible, I stepped forward, black cloak snapping about my armored shoulders.
"Look above you, friend. The battle is done," I gestured.
Not unlike the colossi graven above us all, until I felt as though I held the burning heavens above me.
"I am Lord Hadrian Marlowe, Knight Victorian of the Empire. We have a gift for the Baroness."
"A gift?"
the man repeated.
"I come to give her back her world," I shouted.
"Were you not told? The siege is lifted.
I say again, the battle is done."
In the silence that followed, Pellino muttered,
"Bit slow, aren't they?"
A man stepped out from the shadow of a second-story arch upon the balcony of the building ahead. He wore a dun greatcoat over his scratched white armour, but his bald head was bare, and though he wore a plasma rifle on a strap over one shoulder, he raised his hands to mirror mine.
"Her ladyship said, but I did not dare believe."
The relief in his tone had an almost physical weight.
10 years. Is it really over?"
"I have orders from the Emperor and Lord Titus Hauptmann to bring your Baroness back to Marinus with me," I said by way of answer.
"She must give her account of all that happened here to the Strategos, that he might determine what may be done to restore your world." The man shook his head, though whether in negation or disbelief I could not say. He rested one hand on the wall beside him, sagged as a man who has relieved himself of a terrible weight. Presently he shook himself.
"Stand down, you men,"
he said, and vanished within. From the ruined buildings all around, I felt, more than heard, the shifting of boots and swish of cloaks as men relaxed. My own men did likewise, settling back to rest. A moment later, the bald captain emerged from the shadows of the lower door, the tails of his coat flapping on the wind. Half a dozen men filtered out behind him, sans order, each man's expression more hollow-eyed and hangdog than the last. The captain saluted, fist abreast as he bowed slightly.
"I can't believe it."
"Were you not sent to greet us?"
"We were, aye, but still..."
His eyes flickered to Valka standing at my side, and I knew how out of place she must look to him. A Tavrosi witch, golden-eyed, raven-haired and tattooed, the shoulder of her red jacket black-feathered, her whole aspect almost as foreign as the xenobites who had burned his world.
We've been trapped 10 years, Lordship. You're certain the Pale have gone?
I was growing tired of the man's disbelief. What's your name, soldier? Coming back to himself, the fellow saluted again, fixed his eyes on a point over my shoulder.
Marrow, sir. Vehan Marrow, captain of the Lady's Guard.
At this he glanced around, taking in the haggard collection at his back.
What's left of it, at any rate?
Vehan, I thought, glancing up at the colossus on the left. Like the old baron. I extended my hand. Marrow looked at me a moment, surprised to find a lord of the Imperium offering his hand like a common soldier. He took it only apprehensively. Good to meet you, Captain, I said, and nodded in a way that said we should proceed. I am Hadrian Marlowe, as I say. This is my... I stumbled, about to say the word paramour, as I turned to gesture at Valka, and while it was so, I was not sure how she would take the label, and so said, Companion. Valka Ondera of the Tavrosi. The man's eyes widened.
A witch?
A doctor, she said icily, using the Tavrosi word, Vexrai. I translated for the perplexed captain and waved him forward. Lead the way, Marrow. They kept looking at the sky. I have never forgotten that. Every dozen or so steps, either Marrow or one of his men would stop and glance up at the clouds, where the Cielcin fleet fell burning and lit the sky like so many paper prayer lanterns. Step by dozen steps, Marrow and his men led us toward the foot of Aram's Colossus, where I spied the huge lifts that ran up behind the statue to the top of the rock. They were ruined, but we did not make for them in any case. Instead, we circled the Inselberg and descended along a paved street where the barracks of the city guard stood carved into the very foundation of the rock along our left. The invaders had carved the round symbols of their speech into the stones, with claws or the points of knives. Windows stood smashed, doors staved in. There were no bodies. Not any more.
Lower city's worse, Marrow said. They burned the palace, but that was after they landed and broke through our defence. They bombed the city. Firebombed it. Plasma. Scorched the whole damn thing once they'd got all they were getting from it.
What of the rest of the planet? Valka asked, hurrying along beside me. Marrow shook his head, but did not break stride.
We know they hit the other cities, Aramsa, Thagur, Port Reach, but we lost all contact early on. The Cielcin tore down the satellite grid, and what hard lines we had, they cut before the first year was out. We had the telegraph, that's how we got to you, but we can't raise anyone here on the planet. We could be all there is, for all we know.
Polino cursed. Raising a hand for quiet, I said, There were more than 40 million people on Thagura by your own census, Captain. They cannot all be gone. The captain shrugged. Up ahead on the left, the squarish shapes of the barracks buildings gave way, allowing for channels between them that pierced the stone of the rock like blind alleys, creating narrow streets that led up and down steps to hidden chambers within that lonely mountain. The heavy metal door of some hangar or garage stood shut and scarred on the main avenue. And further on I saw the thin shapes of spears hammered into the earth at irregular intervals. Green banners, tattered and long faded, flapped there, each tall almost as I was and thin. They were not the banners of House Malyan, and at this distance I could not read the alien ruins painted or embroidered on them. But I knew the skulls that decorated their posts were those of men. The tired captain stopped before one of the narrow alleyways and turned to face me.
I pray you may be right, Lordship. Earth knows I pray. But 10 years is a long time. Maybe some of the desert folk got away, or some of the Archons and their family survived in other bunkers, but the cities?
He only shook his head, and rubbing his bald scalp with a gauntleted hand, he turned and gestured down the passage.
It's this way.
The great lords of the Imperium had been digging tunnels since the days of the God Emperor. The dangers of inter-house warfare were never zero, and shielded or no, the great palaces and estates of the various barons, counts, dukes and marquises were ever targets for orbital bombardment, whatever the great charter and the formal rules of war may say. There was hardly a palace beneath any of the Sollan Empire's half a billion suns that did not possess something like the bunkers in which Gadar Malyan and her court found herself. Some planets and castles possessed only the most rudimentary of bolt holes, sufficient to sustain a lesser lord, his family, and a scarce dozen or more retainers, while others boasted a complex warren of tunnels from which a planet's resistance might be directed. Still others were the palaces themselves. Whole halls and galleries resided in darkness below the earth. They were relics of an older time, when man battled man for honour and for gain. How prescient that need had been, and how fortunate. In preparing to battle ourselves, we had prepared for the invaders, for the Cielcin to sweep in from galactic north and lay waste to our many worlds. Valka and I turned down the narrow alleyway, Polino and the men of our guard behind. Three of Marrow's men hurried on ahead, headlamps illuminating the path as they reached the top of a winding stair that angled down. At the bottom, a pair of men in tan cloaks like Marrow's greeted us with curt nods, and from the way they saluted Marrow, I guess they'd been left to hold the garret. The room itself was dark, and from what little I saw, I guessed it had been an intake chamber of the sort one finds in the offices of urban prefects, under every sun. It was not hard to imagine criminals dragged off the streets of Seldona and hauled in to explain themselves to a prefect before being dragged down to lockup. I spied reinforced glass on the inner doors and empty lockers, their doors twisted and strewn about the place, where once the effects of detainees were kept. "The entrance to the bunker is through the dungeons?" I asked, somewhat surprised.
"No," Marrow answered. "Through the Castellan's offices, through here."
He gestured, then turned back to his men.
"Tilcho, Garen, you two stay here until my signal. It's quiet out there, but that doesn't mean we haven't been followed."
"Aye, sir."
Once we passed through the intake chamber, we followed Marrow's men along the ruined hall. It seemed there was nowhere the Xenobites had not gotten, for here too were signs of looting and more rude graffiti. When we hurried down another three levels by a spiral flight of stairs, Marrow asked,
"Is it true, my lordship, what they say of you?"
I had passed Marrow then, and flinched as though the man had rammed a dagger between my shoulder blades. Had the story reached even here? Is it true you can't be killed? Valka's golden eyes, artificial as they were, confections of metal and glass, glowed at me in the dimness, her face opened in concern. She had been there, had seen me die, had screamed as the inhuman Prince Aranata's blade struck off my head, as had Polino and a number of my guard. The story had begun to get out, how I had simply appeared again, alive, how I had saved Valka and my people from the prince at the last moment. To think the story had come as far as Thagura, whispered from soldier to soldier as the legions travelled between the stars. "No blade can cut the devil down," they said. But Marrow did not ask the dreadful question. Instead he said,
"Did you really kill one of their princes in single combat? The Cielcin, I mean."
I felt my shoulders relax and smiled. Valka smiled too and turned away.
"Don't believe everything you hear, Captain," I said, smiling after her and glancing at Polino, who had fought by my side. I had help.
"But you did kill one."
"Aranata Otiolo," I said, thoughts running back to that monstrous prince. Nearly 8 feet tall and thin as death, but broad-shouldered with arms that reached its knees and horns long as daggers above its broad white face. Yes. The men about us whispered in surprise and admiration. In all the centuries of war between our two kinds, I was the first, the very first, to kill one of their princes face to face. Titus Hauptmann, Cassian Powers, the great heroes of the early Crusade, these had killed princes by the dozen, whole blood clans, but they had done so with the fire of their guns, with atomics and armadas to outgun the sun itself for firepower. I alone had met such a lord of demons sword for sword. I had lost, and lived only because they had brought me back. The quiet, the ancient beings whose ghosts I first encountered in the ruins on Emesh. They had handed me back my life, and I didn't even know why. Maro's mouth hung open, surprised to hear the answer he'd expected.
"And the one that attacked us here?"
I shook my head. Escaped to warp before we could engage. The great worldship that housed the vast majority of the Cielcin presence at Thagura had been far out beyond the planet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.